Hello friends, this is the second section of the spirituality and health that is presented in the preventive care grand rounds. We go directly to the topic, but again, spirituality and health, we discuss issues related to some spiritual principles based in the Bible or the traditions of the Seventh-day Adventists and science and health, and that's our main focus. Today the topic is Thou Shall Not Kill. And so we have four points that we are going to explore, mostly the two last ones. Shall not kill yourself and shall not kill animals are the ones. Let's start with the first one. Thou shall not kill, literally murder. There was a little bit of a discussion among theologians to see if the verse in the Bible says murder or kill. If it's murder, it restricts a part of killing, just you shall not murder, but other killings would be allowed. We will not enter in this discussion, but it looks like the evidence are more like this verse is related to kill in general, that killing is not something that is from God. And one of the evidence in favor of this thought is what happened in Luke 22, verses 49 to 51. I'm going to read that and then I will make some comments. One of Jesus' companions drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. And this was Peter. And then Jesus responded, "For all who draw the sword will die by the sword." Then in John 18:11, he said again, related to the same event, "Put your sword back in its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup of that the Father has given me?" So this is a meaning for the Christian religion that there is no place for murder, abortions, euthanasia, homicide, suicide, genocide. In the Christian religion should not have, I mean, if you are a Christian, you should not get involved on killing other people. Like if they don't believe in the same faith that you believe, I mean, there is no place for that. However, we have a bad Christian history. Even though there is no place for killings, the church, when united with the state, developed some institutions that were killing people, like the Crusades, the Inquisition, the colonization, the conquistadores, the slavery, and then the wars during the Reform Movement, where both Christians, Catholic Christians and Reformed Christians, they kind of fight with each other. So this was not in God's mind or in Christ's mind. If God wants to force us to do something, if you don't do, they kill us or he will kill us, this is not choice. He offers us a freedom of choice. If you wanna serve him, it's up to you. But he is not gonna kill you like a threat for you to serve him. And so that's the main principle here. The other application of this commandment is thou shalt not kill with words and actions. And this was addressed by Jesus Christ in Matthew 5:22. "But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subjected to judgment." Again, anyone who says to a brother or sister, "Raca," is answerable to the court. And anyone who says, "You fool," will be in danger of the fire of hell. So Raka in Greek or in Aramaic means empty-headed, fool, foolish, godless. So those are terms that people use when they are very upset with somebody else. So when you are angry, when you have a temper to put people down or criticize people, so those are the things that Jesus was talking about, that this is not good, and this is something that might be killing people. Be careful, words can kill. I like this this picture, because this is reality. Sometimes we are not killing physically, but by our words. And then we get to the issue that is important to us. Thou shall not kill yourself. You shall not kill yourself. And I am not discussing the issue about suicide, even though it's important. Suicide prevention, suicide has been one of the main cause of death in the United States, and it should be addressed, but that's not the discussion now. We are talking about long-term suicide prevention that is related to lifestyle. Unhealthy behaviors might kill, like cancer produced by smoking or by obesity or by alcohol. So those are lifestyle that might kill. I remember when I was in medical school, we have a professor in psychiatry, and we have a group of four or five students together in a room, and this guy was smoking one cigarette after another inside of the room, and we were talking about suicide, and one of the students raised the issue, if you are smoking, isn't that a form of suicide? But the doctor, the professor, didn't want to address that topic, and he distracted ourselves and continued smoking his cigarette. We have to change the lifestyle that can kill, and that's the point that I mentioned here. It can be cigarette, can be alcohol, can be food, can be lack of exercise. All of these things are important, and I believe they belong to the commandment, thou shalt not kill. For instance, if you eat wrong foods, if you eat too much, if you get overweight, if you get to the situation that you cannot control more your eating, you might get in trouble with cancers. And we have 11 cancers on the left picture here, related to being overweight and obese, and this is by the World Cancer Research Fund. And then you have the National Cancer Institute that added at least three more cancers to the list. Meningioma, that is related now, multiple myeloma, that is a cancer from the blood cells, and then the cancer of thyroid. So those are cancers that might be related. That's what is what we call long-term self-suicide or self-killing. And then the last part of our analysis is, thou shall not kill animals. And this is a verse that a quote by Ellen White, that was an early founder of the Adventist organization. Think of the cruelty to animals that meat eating involves, and its effect on those who inflict and those who behold it. How it destroys the tenderness with which we should regard these creatures of God. So, one of the reasons that Adventists are advised not to eat animals is related to maltreatment of animals. And so we don't need to discuss much about that, but this is a reality in our world today. Would you eat one of your own? Then why eat another animal? So this is from the PETA, the movement against the maltreatment of animals. And they promote being vegan, and they promote that we should not be eating animals, because even if you eat animals, you kind of are an accomplice of the ones that are killing the animals. As long as man continues to be the ruthless destroyer of lower living beings, he will never know health or peace. For as long as men massacre animals, they will kill each other. So I don't know. I mean, I remember one time, and this was not a Christian guy, this was Pythagoras, a Greek scientist or Greek philosopher. But I would say that I read a report about one of these mass killings person, and then the interesting part, not interesting, but the one fact was that this guy was raised as a killer, was as a hunter. His father would give him the rifles and teach him, and for his whole life he was killing animals. And then something happened in his head, and then he start killing people, or one time he killed a bunch of people. So this is one case. There are several other factors on that, but just to mention that once you start killing living beings, it looks like it's not that far from killing a human being. Another thing related to not kill is because we, as we mentioned in the first section of this spirituality and health forums, we were created vegetarians. And then we believe that the vegetarian diet is the ideal diet for human beings. And then we believe that in the future we will be in heaven, where there will not be death, and then you cannot eat meat there. So you can imagine that if you don't get used to that here, and you have a repulse for being vegetarian or for vegetarian foods, how can you handle the diet that is going to be in heaven, that is going to be a vegetarian diet? You might say, well, God will change my appetite. Well, I agree on that, but we are talking about now, so maybe you need to start doing something now, as we know that what's going to happen there. There are also scientific reasons for not killing, because meat is related to several problems, like red meat is related to colon cancer, and processed meat is related to colon cancer, to pancreas cancer, and maybe stomach and esophagus cancer too. Red meat and saturated fat from red meat can increase the risk of heart disease. And now we have a connection between red meat and diabetes. It looks like the fat in red meat, the saturated fat, is related to insulin resistance, affecting the receptors in the cells. If you decide, okay, I'm not gonna eat red meat, but I'm gonna continue eating chicken and fish, you might have other problems there. Like most of the chicken is contaminated. I would say 100% of chicken has either of these three bacteria: Salmonella, Campylobacter, or Escherichia coli, or coli. So this is true. That's why the advice is, if you eat chicken, you have to cook very well, or bake very well, or roast very well. You should not eat those things raw. The problem is that if you are gonna cook, you are gonna kill the bacteria that is gonna be still in the chicken. And so you are eating chicken with that bacteria. Well, sorry to mention about that. But then we have the problem with the mercury contaminants in fish. And then, and it's not just mercury, there are evidences that they have contaminants with pesticides also in the water that goes to the fish, and especially fish that go and live close to big cities. They might be feeding on places where we have the sewage, and then all of these pesticides and contaminants are in that water. There are also an application of hormones, antibiotics, preservatives, both in chicken, in fish, and in red meat or cows. You might say, okay, fish, you can buy fish from a fish farm, but fish farm, fish from farms have all other problems. They might not have the contaminants that we mentioned before, because they are creating kind of a clean system, but they develop parasites. And then for you to get rid of parasites, you have to put a medicine there. So either you eat fish with parasites, or with a medicine, or some pesticides or parasiticides to kill, to clean, to produce fish without these bugs. And finally, if we consider those two last effects, food for the world. It has to be plant-based, because there is not, there will be a big crisis if we continue to eat hamburgers as we are eating now, because the world, the production of meat will not be sufficient for the demand that is being created. So if we don't stop this fast food movement that is around the world, we are gonna get in a crisis that they will have to find other sources of protein. Fortunately, we have Beyond Meat, and we have Impossible Burgers that are coming, that are based in other products, soy and nuts and other sources of protein that are more vegetable. This will make a difference, and we know that if we go to Burger King, Carl's Jr.'s, I'm not identifying them, as, but I know that they have these burgers made by vegetable sources. And finally, to save the planet. It looks like the production of meat, the production of a protein from meat sources require more energy, and this energy will demand more green. You produce more greenhouses, because to get the meat, you need to spend more oil and more carbons to produce the energy. If you the comparison is that one to produce 1 gram of 1 kilogram of energy from meat, you will need 1/10 of what you need from vegetables. Meaning, in other words, 10 times more from animals to produce the same gram of energy from soybeans or from vegetable sources. So this is survival, I would say. Going in that direction is survival. I remember one of the stories that I have. I used to have cows in a clinic that I was director in Brazil, and one of the cows got sick, and she was sick for more than 1 week, and we didn't know, and everybody was drinking her milk, and including the patients and the families and the staff. and we have to put her to death. And then what happened is that the cow was sick and we didn't know. So you can imagine in an environment that we thought we are doing the best that we could for the animals, but still we have flies, we have bats, we have mosquitoes, we have contaminants in foods, and the animals are exposed to many diseases. So we had to move to a soy-based milk. If you love animals called pets, why you eat animals called dinner? And then there is a time that we discuss. This is a recording of the presentation, only the presentation. We don't have time for, we don't have the recording for the discussion. So thank you very much, and I'll see you in the next edition of Spirituality and Health within the Preventive Care Grand Rounds.